and welcome to Game Onassis Weekly, your one-stop shop for video game news, keeping up with the latest and biggest stories so you don't have to. I'm your host, Janet Garcia, and today we're talking about the Nintendo Direct, as well as a bunch of other news stories that came out this week, including Blizzcon 2, so a lot in the way of game updates and announcements. So let's start things off with some main general stories. Following up on something we touched on last episode, there is a new PogChamp, and it is Komodo Hype. So essentially, the new PogChamp is just a really excited lizard, which makes sense to this one because internet, you know, it has a really goofy sort of look to it. So I can see why people found this appealing. I think also just an animal face is probably has a little bit more mass appeal than a person, because despite how popular that person may be, I think this is just like a little bit more of a general audience can grab a hold to it. The result of this just felt a little bit anticlimactic given the lead up and also the severity of what the lead up was. So, you know, we'll see how it goes. I imagine this will be the PogChamp icon for some time. I don't really see a reason for them needing to change this one. Updates as far as CDPR getting their code stolen, which is something we talked about a few episodes ago. CD Projekt Red is using DMCA to take down tweets sharing the stolen game code. This comes from Lorenzo Franceschi Bicciari over at Vice Games. And that sounds like exactly what it is, where you don't own the rights to share out that information or that product or that thing, so you can't share it out, and that's a great way for them to deal with that coming out publicly. And hopefully there are no major repercussions for the studio in terms of having the code stolen to begin with. More follow-ups on stories that we have covered previously. DualSense Drift could actually be a little more serious than I initially thought. So at first there were just sort of these rumblings of DualSense Drift being an issue. But as written by Joe Scrubbles over at IGN, PS5 DualSense controller drift class action lawsuit filed against Sony. It reads, a U.S. law firm has filed a class action lawsuit against Sony, alleging that the PS5 DualSense controller is defective due to drift, and that Sony was aware of the problem without disclosing it. The suit calls Sony's conduct fraudulent, deceptive, unlawful, and unfair. Scrubbles continues on, writing, the complaint describes the PS5 DualSense controller as defective, as it contains a defect that results in characters or gameplay moving on the screen without user command or manual operation of the joystick, known popularly as controller drift. Further, the complaint alleges that Sony has, at all relevant times, been aware of the problems with drift through online consumer complaints, complaints made by consumers directly to it, and through its own pre-release testing. The suit also mentions controller repairs being limited, which is something that was touched on by Kotaku's reporting last week as well. So we'll see how these things develop. I would love for consumers to get justice for these issues, especially in the wake of Joy-Con drift. That's still something that I know me as like a Nintendo person, I've dealt with that a bunch. It's a very expensive problem, and it feels like there hasn't really been anything that has resolved it, both from this not happening anymore and also being sort of given anything for the, for lack of a less extreme phrasing, pain and suffering endured by this issue. So seeing this in the wake of Joy-Con drift definitely has me wanting Sony to take some type of serious action for it. All that being said, I still not have had controller drift, and I've had my DualSense since launch, since before launch technically. Hoping this doesn't end up happening to me, but that doesn't mean that's not an issue or that's not something that should be dealt with. Here's an interesting one. Steam developer banned after trying to trick users about positive reviews. This report comes over from Patrick Klepek at Vice Games. And there's a game on Steam called Emoji Evolution. It is by very positive developer, published by very positive, and the way Steam is laid out, it puts that really, really close to where the actual review description is, where it says like mixed or mostly positive. Patrick actually did speak to the developer, who kind of talks about why they decided to do this and how reviews are so influential, and sort of trying to find a way to like bolster attention and positive attention on the game. But this kind of structure on the internet, Steam sort of noticed as a result of that coverage and then banned the developer on Friday. So yeah, this was just interesting, a really unique story. And I encourage you to go to the article, which is linked in the description, and kind of read more of that back and forth that Patrick had with his developer. But yeah, apparently you can't do that. It's not allowed. Speaking of cute, interesting stories, President Biden beat his granddaughter at Mario Kart. This comes over from Zach Zirzen at Kotaku. And this is super brief. It was something that just shared by his granddaughter over on Instagram that got picked up. And she said, although he is a little rusty, he still barely won. And the funny thing about this is that saying he's a little rusty implies that he plays Mario Kart to some level of frequency. I think this is also kind of amusing coming off of Joe Biden's Animal Crossing Island, which of course we know that's like a staffer situation. Like that's probably not Biden actually playing and working on that island, but the idea of these larger figures playing video games is always interesting. But funnily enough, the picture of Mario Kart 2 was like the Mario Kart arcade machine, which controls very differently than Mario Kart. I feel like it's not a testament to your Mario Kart skills to be able to rock that machine, but you know, not really the point anyway, but just something I did want to highlight that it wasn't like on console or anything like that. Still a valid win. So shout out to Biden on that win. And this was over the weekend when Biden made his first visit to presidential retreat Camp David. I would love to also just play the games that are over at Camp David. I think that'd be a really interesting historical moment. Next up, the future of game accessibility on Xbox. This is a blog post written over on Xbox's website. In early 2019, members of the Microsoft Gaming Accessibility Team set out on a mission to create the Xbox Accessibility Guidelines, a comprehensive set of best practices to support the game industry in driving accessibility efforts forward. And in this post, they mentioned improvements they've made to these guidelines, things like improved language, a clearer goal, improved overview, scoring questions, key areas to target, background and foundational info, implementation guideline examples. But in terms of actually using these guidelines to improve your games, they mentioned that developers now have the option to send Microsoft their Xbox or PC titles and have it analyzed and validated against the recommendations provided in the Xbox accessibility guidelines. Where issues are found, they are noted with reproduction steps, screenshots, and other information to help the developer understand what aspect of a given experience may be challenging for certain gamers with disabilities. Perhaps the most important aspect of the program, however, is the inclusion of gamers with disabilities as part of the testing project. Every test passed includes members of the gaming and disability community to not only run test cases against games, but to provide their feedback and insights as well. I think this is just such an awesome thing. So helpful to have created this and then also be building on it in a really active way, making it easier for developers to actually take advantage of not just the guidelines, but have support in doing it. I think it's one thing to say, hey, here's what we stand for, here's what we're about. And it's another thing to actually support that happening, like to make sure that your actions align with your written and stated vision. And I feel like Xbox allowing for developers to send their games in to kind of be checked over and reviewed and given that feedback is them doing just that. And this is just super cool to see. And I'm really hoping that this generation is the most accessible generation in games ever. All right, now there's a bunch of big deal events that have occurred this past week. We had BlizzCon, we had the Nintendo Direct. So I'm going to break down all the biggest updates from those events. And then that'll lead us into game events, releases, and updates just in general. So starting with BlizzCon 2021, I'm actually just going to read Felicia Miranda's roundup over at IGN. The Blizzard Arcade Collection was announced and is already out on PC and consoles, and the collection features the Lost Vikings, Black Throne, and Rock and Roll Racing, both in their classic and newly enhanced formats. We got WoW updates, Shadowlands patch 9.1, Chains of Domination was announced, and the Burning Crusade Classic expansion was also announced. Chains of Domination comes with a new location called Korthia, and that new location comes with new quests, a new 10 boss raid, and an 8 boss mega dungeon, and more. As you can tell, I don't play WoW. And the Burning Crusade features things like a level cap of 70, 2 new races, flying mounts, and more. Hearthstone is getting its own Warcraft-themed expansion called Forged in the Barrens, and a new mode called Mercenaries. And the Mercenary mode has roguelike missions and strategic RPG gameplay. Diablo fans will be happy to see a first look at Diablo 4's rogue class. And Diablo 2 Resurrected is heading to PC, PS4, PS5, Xbox One, Series X, and Nintendo Switch. So keep an eye out for that remaster. And there was a bunch of announcements in terms of Overwatch 2 and what that looks like, things like new maps, hero look changes, PvP changes, and a bunch of other stuff, campaign details. And one of the biggest things was a new character, Sojourn, was shown off. So we can probably expect a full-on Sojourn detailed reveal coming up. And Sojourn will be the first Black woman character. It took 33 characters to get here. But there we go. And now on to the Nintendo Direct, something that I am admittedly a lot more passionate about. As you can probably tell, I'm not a Blizzard person, but Nintendo, I'm all here for it. I did my live reaction to the event over on Twitch. And for these, I'm just going to run through these. I will be adding my opinions as they sort of come up. And we're going to go through this in terms of actual release dates, release windows, announcements, and products. And spoilers, I didn't think the Direct was that good. I thought it was pretty disappointing, but let's actually get into what was announced. Capcom Arcade Stadium is out now already because it released that day. Project Triangle Strategy is Square Enix's Octopath successor, and the demo is already available, but the game itself won't be here until 2022. I actually did play a little bit of this demo. A lot of dialogue. Very dialogue heavy, beautiful art. I love the way you can rotate the area and you can kind of change the perspective from being like super zoomed in to like way zoomed out and kind of this overhead view to one, give you another glance at where you can explore when you're not in battle, and then two, to give you another view of the playing field when you are in battle. But this is not exactly my genre of enjoyment or expertise, so I took a long time just to die. It definitely is challenging, and it does note in the demo that, hey, this is gonna be challenging, we're kind of throwing you into the middle of this story, but they are looking for feedback on this as well, so go check it out, it's free, let them know what you think. Ghost and Goblin Resurrection is coming out February 25th. Stubbs the Zombie in Rebel Without a Pulse is coming to Switch, PS4, Xbox One, PC on March 16th. Tales from the Borderlands is coming to Switch on March 24th. I've been wanting to play this actually because everyone says it's like an amazing story experience, so maybe this will be the time I get around to it. SaGa Frontier Remastered comes out April 15th. Plants vs. Zombies Battle for the Neighborville Complete Edition comes out March 19th. Knockout City, which is EA's dodgeball sport, extreme sports game, that comes out May 21st for Switch, Xbox, PlayStation, and PC. And fun fact, it is developed by the folks that made Mario Kart Live. DC Superhero Girls Teen Power comes out June 4th. This does not look like a game for me. I think this is probably just something nice for maybe like a younger audience, perhaps. But yeah, it was not very impressed by what I saw on this trailer. Ninja Gaiden Master Collection, June 10th. Legend of Mana Remaster comes out June 24th, and it was also coming out on PS4 and PC. Moving on to one of the big ones, Mario Golf Super Rush comes out June 25th. A lot of people are really hyped for this. I've never been a Mario sports person, but everyone was kind of going wild for this just because Mario Sports. So yeah, this could be a fun one, but it seems to be only one of the very few things that Nintendo has lined up for this year, because there's not a whole lot left to go over, but we do have a couple more things. Skyward Sword HD is coming to Switch July 16th, and with this, there is no Breath of the Wild 2 news. This was sort of mentioned and highlighted as a, hey, you know, a lot of the ideas from Breath of the Wild came from Skyward Sword, so, you know, check out this game. But Skyward Sword, you're either someone who is a Skyward Sword apologist, or you're like, this game isn't very good. That's kind of it. There's not really a, that's it. Those are the two camps that you can be in. I personally think the art style looks really ugly to me. I hate how the art looks, and also I'm not a big fan of motion controls, so I'll probably be passing on this, but, you know, anything can happen, so okay. It's kind of a, it's like a bad consolation prize for Breath of the Wild 2 not being talked about. So it's kind of a rough go, but that's what we'll be doing this summer. We golf in Skyward Sword. No More Heroes 3 is August 27th. I'm not a No More Heroes person, so that kind of is what it is. Moving on to release windows, Miitopia is set for May 2021. That is that 3DS RPG with Miis. Sure, you know, like, I guess that's the thing that we can port over to Switch. Sure, why not? World's End Club is set for 2021, and it's from the creators of Danganronpa and the Zero Escape series. This is going to be a side-scrolling, narrative-based adventure game that involves a journey across Japan. So, lightly interested in that. Samurai Warriors 5 is coming out summer 2021. The Outer Wilds is getting a port over to Switch that's also coming out summer 2021. Also coming out in the summer is Fall Guys heading to Switch, and it's also heading to Xbox, so you'll be able to play that on non-PlayStation systems. Neon White is coming out winter 2021 for Switch and PC. This is an FPS platformer card game published by Annapurna, so you already know him about it, and also developed by Ben Esposito, who made Donut County. So that has enough for me to be interested in this just because of the people that are behind it. And the gameplay does look interesting, but I'm not completely sold on it yet. It's a pretty bold design. We'll see if it pays off for them. And some very generalized windows. Famicom Detective Club, The Missing Heir, and Famicom Detective Club, The Girl Who Stands Behind are going to be coming out sometime in 2021. This is cool in the sense that this is the first time these games are getting localized, so that's always interesting to me. And they are story-driven experiences or visual novels, so that's a genre I really like. I'm not completely blown away by what I've seen, but yeah, that could be interesting. Star Wars Hunters is going to be coming out on Switch and the App Store / Google Play, so mobile, later this year, and no subscription to Nintendo Switch Online is needed to play this. And this is a competitive arena combat game, so sure. Let's do some team-based multiplayer battles with some Star Wars characters. See how it goes down, why not? And the other big announcement is Splatoon 3 2022. Yes, this is far away, but you know what? I'm excited about it. I'm absolutely thrilled by it. And this tells me that, hey, Splatoon is still getting support. And I personally am pro having it be a series. I like having the different games. I liked going from Splatoon 1 to Splatoon 2. I'm ready for a new campaign. I'm ready for more modes. I'm ready for some quality of life improvements. I'm hyped by the new hairstyles. There's like a robot crab in this. There's like an apocalyptic desert, abandoned, stumbling onto a new town vibe or on a train. It's giving me Spirited Away. Like, I was all about this. I was so excited to see this. And this is definitely the best thing to me that came out of this Direct. But in addition to all these release dates and windows, we did have a few announcements. Pyra and
Mithra
from Xenoblade, a game that I have not played, joins Smash in March 2021. And also happening in March, we're going to have an Animal Crossing update that's going to include items from the Mario universe. It'll include outfits like a Mario outfit, a Luigi one, a Peach one, a Wario one. Those are like kind of the confirmed ones so far that we saw in the trailer. There are warp pipes that you can take. You can set up like two warp pipes, right? You can go through one warp pipe and then come out of the other warp pipe. So you can basically add fast travel to your island, which is amazing. Super excited. I can go straight from my house to the store or like just anywhere. It's just amazing. I'm really, really hyped about that. And I'm curious to see if other items have interesting integrations like that. I really hope so. This is going to be really cool. The actual update drops February 25th, but like the stuff gets activated on March 1st. So I'm guessing that I don't know if you can time travel to the event on the 25th. That kind of is what it implies, but we'll see. And Hyrule Warriors getting an expansion pass. It's going to include two content drops. And finally, for some products, not a whole lot that came out of this, which I was also kind of bummed about, but Hades is getting a physical edition that's going to come with a code for the soundtrack and a 32-page art booklet. So yes, we're here for physical media. We're here for stuff coming in with the physical media and it not just being the cartridge in a plastic clamshell case. That's happening March 19th. It's also a great way to incentivize anyone that still hasn't gotten a Hades yet. You can get a physical now. Really cool. And I may not be excited for Skyward Sword, but the Skyward Sword themed Joy-Con look really nice. The design is a little basic. It's not subtle. It's not like super classy, but I think it looks better than like those third party sort of designs. It's like a step up from that, but a step below like what we got with Animal Crossing. So that I think that's a solid place to be. I think they look really cool. A little annoyed that there's two different shades of blue, but I'm also just trying to accept that a lot of times when Nintendo has Joy-Con, they have one be one color and one be another one, and like I'm just gonna have to live with it because that's the world we live in. So yeah, that was everything from the Direct. Again, my favorite thing was Splatoon 3. Everything else I didn't really care that much about. Like sometimes there were fun facts, but it wasn't anything that got me really excited. Splatoon 3 was the only thing that got me excited at all. But let me know in the comments or on social what you thought of the Nintendo Direct and what your favorite thing was from it and how you felt about it, whether or not you thought it was good. For me, I was like, we waited a long time for this and I don't think it was worth it. So that's where I'm at with the Nintendo Direct. Moving on to game events, releases, and updates. We've already talked a lot about this topic already, but moving away from Blizzard stuff and away from Nintendo stuff, we have more things to share. Metro Exodus is getting a next-gen update. I'm a big Metro Exodus fan. I didn't play the other games. I only played Metro Exodus. I don't think you need to play the other games to enjoy Metro Exodus. And Metro Exodus was wonderful. It is a shooter. I know some people were like, oh, the shooting isn't that good. I can't really speak to that that much because I don't have like a strong shooting background. But if you're someone that, I don't know, just enjoys good games, like honestly, it's fantastic. It is a little bit scary. It's like there's a few scary moments. So, you know, keep that in mind if you're very easily scared. But I'm very easily scared and I was able to handle it. So I think you'll be okay. It looks beautiful already. So I'm really excited to see what this next gen update does for it. Go check it out. It's awesome. And it has, like, a really, really good story is the thing. The gameplay is great. The story is wonderful. It has, like, some crafting elements in terms of just, not like you don't literally craft things, but the way you upgrade your weapons and stuff. It's good. There are spiders, though, in it. There are some, like, really big spiders at one point in the game. So if you have arachnophobia, that might be a problem for you. But other than that, it's awesome. And speaking of boost, Microsoft has announced an FPS boost, an enhancement system for backwards compatible games on the Xbox Series X and the Series S. And the FPS boost will be applied to select games, and the first five are going to be Far Cry 4, New Super Lucky's Tale, why? Sniper Elite 4, Use FC 4, and Watch Dogs 2. Interesting suite of games. I do appreciate the somewhat diverse spread. I think it could have been a little more diverse, but yeah, New Super Lucky's Tale, I was not expecting up in those frames for New Super Lucky's Tale. I don't know who is going to really be noticing that on the level of these other games because it doesn't seem to need it as much, but hey, everything could use some enhancements, right? And lastly, Overcooked All You Can Eat is coming to Switch, PS4, Xbox One, and PC March 23rd. This is the bundle that puts all Overcooked content together. So you have Overcooked 1, Overcooked 2, and all of the DLCs all in one convenient package. I've been playing this on PS5 because it's already on PS5. It came out last year for PS5. I love it. That's the main reason I'm kind of mentioning this one. And also, it just happened to catch my eye because this kind of porting happens all the time, but yeah, play this if you haven't already. I'm really looking forward to platinuming it on PS5 and on 2 for the free. As I mentioned before, Project Triangle Strategy, which is a working title, by the way, it's not going to be the title, though also Project Octopath Traveler ended up being Octopath Traveler, so it's probably just going to be called Triangle Strategy, if we're really being honest, but that has a demo out on Switch, so go check that out if you haven't already. And we got some Game Pass updates. For the second half of February, we got Code Vein, February 18th coming to PC. Pillars of Eternity 2 Deadfire Ultimate Edition is going to be on cloud and console. That's February 18th as well. Wreckfest, cloud, console, and PC, February 18th. Killer Queen Black, cloud and console, February 23rd. Dirt 5 is coming to cloud, console, and PC, February 25th. Elite Dangerous is coming to console, February 25th. Super Mind Control Delete is coming to PC February 25th. So check those out, Game Pass users. And that brings us to our final topic, the Shut Up and Take My Money side of things. Xbox is releasing a wireless headset that is supposed to be rivaling the PS5 Pulse 3D headset. And it'll be $99. For me personally, I'm not someone that is that level of an audiophile, and I don't play games that require me to be able to hear really well, so it's not something that I'll be rushing to. I rarely game with a headset on unless I am streaming or something, like in my own free time when I'm playing games. If I'm on a console, I just have it coming out of the crummy TV speaker is, and I know that's egregious to some people, but that is how I live. However, I did want to list this because headsets are a big deal in the gaming community, and this might be appealing to you, so if you're an Xbox user, this might be something worth your time. But if you're someone that cares that deeply about sound, I recommend waiting until, you know, reviews and things come out and you can kind of get a sense on whether or not this is a good purchase for you. But if you're in the market for a headset, it may be worth waiting for this one to come out, seeing how it is, and seeing if you decide to pick this one over what you were currently looking at. And those are about all the stories we have for this week's episode. Thank y'all so much for listening. Be sure to review on any podcast platform that you are listening on. You can head over to youtube.com/gameonassist to check out the video version, which does include some B-roll in it, or if you just want to sign off in the comments there because it's easier for you. While you're there, be sure to like and subscribe as well. And lastly, a huge shout out to folks over on patreon.com/gameonassist who help make this show and all the stuff I do possible. And again, Merch store's new, that's launched. Go check it out. And all patrons get a 10% off code for all of their purchases. So go ahead and sign up for the Patreon. You can get that code, use it, buy some stuff. It'll be a good time. All right, and I will see y'all here next week. Bye.